everybody.
Oh. What is it, babe? Got the order now?
Welcome in, welcome in, welcome in.
Every praise is to our God.
Welcome in, everybody. Welcome in, welcome in, welcome in. I am back home. I'm packed with sodas and stuff.
Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah.
Thank you. Welcome in, welcome in, welcome in. I got a short 15-ish word for you guys. Hi. Yes, I'm back. I'm back. Welcome. We had a great time. Just to give a little backdrop, we were in Hawaii. We went snorkeling and riding glass bottom boats and all kind of stuff. We had a great honeymoon. Unfortunately, I came back to some foolishness, but the devil gets no glory in this live tonight. We're going to give God all the glory, all the praise, all the honor. Tonight is about God. Today and other places, if it's morning there. But we're giving God all the praise, all the glory. God gets it all. No matter what we're going through in life, God can fix anything. God can fix anything. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Yes. So, I'm not going to be long, but when I was on the plane ride back, I had my tablet and I was just reading in the Bible and I stumbled upon Peter, and I just love Peter. I love everything about Peter. But Peter took me to two different places, and I have a lot of highlights in here. If you want to highlight tonight, I'm in, this is 2 Peter, and I'm on verse 8 and 9 is what I highlighted in my tablet. But I have tons of others that I'm going to give out tonight before I get off, that I was just highlighting as I was on the plane ride, just talking with God. So I have two different versions, which this one is highlighted as the King James, but this is my regular Bible over here. But God was speaking to me. So I have a couple of definitions, words that I'm going to actually define for you guys. Thank you guys so much. That I'm going to actually define for you guys. And tonight, you guys, this is what I was cleaning up, and I found a microphone. And I was like, God, why is this speaking to me? And he says, because somebody is about to be passed the microphone, so you better be ready to speak when it comes in your presence. So anyway, that's neither here or there. So, thank you. We actually enjoyed ourselves so much over there. It was amazing. Food, not so much, but everything else was great. So tonight I'm going to give you two words. I'm going to define them, and I'm going to be in Peter. I'm going to be in Peter 2 verses 8 and 9, and then I'm going to jump over to Ephesians 1. So I'm going to be in two different places and give you two very important words. And these words, when I saw them, they jumped out of the pages to me and literally went to speaking to me. So the two words I'm going to define for you tonight is chosen. We should know what chosen is. And peculiar. So those two words are what stood out to me, and I had to highlight them in my Bible, and I had to come home and write it in here as well. So I just came in, I was cleaning up, and I was like, I gotta go live. I gotta get this word out. I'm gonna probably try to go live again tomorrow, just because I had a longer version of what I saw. So the word peculiar, we might think we know what it is, right? It's strange or odd or unusual, like particular or special. In the Old Testament, particular is used in the sense of special or particular treasure. In Exodus 19 verses 5, it says, if ye obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then you should be a particular treasure unto me above all people. It means eccentric, bizarre, extraordinary, exceptional, and most importantly, unique. It means unique. It's so hard in 2023 to be your own person. to be a particular person, a peculiar person. It's so hard to be yourself when everything else is in your face, what you should be, what you should look like, what you should walk like, what's trending, what's not trending. You have so many things, you can scroll up and scroll down and it's gonna tell you that your body has to be this way, that your hair has to be this way, that your edges have to be this way, that you have to have the latest and greatest. You have so many different things shouting at you, telling you to be everything but yourself. But God is saying he's looking for the peculiar people, the special people, the unique ones. Those are the ones he's about to come in and do something for. So I need you to understand that he's looking for his peculiar children. So then he gave me the word chosen. And so I was like, I think we all know what chosen is, being picked, right, God? Pick me. Okay, God, if you're going to use somebody, pick me. If you're going to bless somebody, pick me. It's me, oh Lord, standing in need of prayer. Not my mother, not my brother, but it's me. We know what chosen means. It's me, God. I'm chosen. I'm a generation of the curse breaker. I'm chosen, right? So we think that we know what it is, correct? Correct. So it's having been selected as the best or most appropriate for something. That's the definition in the dictionary. But it says here in Ephesians 1 and 4. Matter of fact, let me give it to you like this. Ephesians 1 and 4 breaks it down a little bit better than, you know, just being picked, just being the man for the job, just being the woman for the job. It's a little bit deeper than that. So Ephesians 1, it says, grace to you and peace, peace from our God, our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has also blessed us and bless us every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Verse 4, just as he has chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame, for in him is love, having predestined us to adoption as the sons of Jesus Christ himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he has made us accepted and beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our sins according to the riches of his grace. So I was sitting there and I was like, okay, God, so you chose us. Not only did you choose us, your blood redeemed us. Not only did you choose us as yours, you adopted us. First, that's very important too, because in there it said that he adopted us, that Christ adopted us, and that his blood was the redemption for us. So not only are we chosen, we're adopted in him, and we are redeemed by his blood. So I was like, okay, God, he says, the peculiar children, my chosen children, the ones that won't conform to society, are redeemed by me, are adopted by me, are loved by me, are chosen by me. I'm looking for my peculiar children. But let me come over to Peter really quick, because this is where the meat and potatoes was when I was talking with God. And I'm not going to be too long. It's about to end in a second. One, because I'm hungry and I've been on a flight for 24 hours and your girl tired and got jet lag. So, yeah. So, initially, I was going to read 2 Peter 8 and 9, but I think I'm going to go up a little bit more just to give it some substance and some context in it. So I'm just going to read 2 and I'm going to go down to 9. It says, therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes desire pure milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. If indeed you have tasted the Lord in his graciousness, coming to him as a loving stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. You got that last little bit right there? Because I had to highlight that part right there. Rejected by who? Rejected by men, but chosen by God. So if men start rejecting you, count it all joy. Because they can't choose you anyway. They ain't got authority over you anyway. God is going to be the one that has the final say. God is going to be the one that has the final say. And Facebook, they not playing. Facebook is typing in the comments that I am chosen. They proclaiming their blessings before I even said what I was going to say. Y'all read my mind. Good job. If you're in here and you believe that this word is for you, I need you to get in the comments and say, I am chosen. I am chosen. I am chosen. The reason I'm not saying I'm, because I'm not going to abbreviate the I am. So it's very important that you type out I am chosen. We can say I'm and do an abbreviation, but in this season, we're not taking no shortcuts. We're going to spell out the I am, because I am is possible and he's going to choose you. So when you're putting I am, you're declaring all your victory. You're declaring who you are. It's not for me. It's for you to know who you are and you to tell the devil that you are indeed chosen. So don't do the I am, like that, the I apostrophe M. You need to go ahead and give God what you owe him. I am chosen. I am chosen for such a time as this. I am a peculiar person. I am the peculiar people that you speak about, God. I am that. I am that I am, God, because I have you. So when the devil is coming at me saying, who sent you the I am? When my problems are looking at me crazy and trying to add up and square up with me, I'm going to look at them, tell them the I am sent me here. When the bills are piling up, I'm going to let it know that I have authority from the I am. When everything is coming against me, I'm going to let it know that the I am is sending me. I am chosen. I am a peculiar person. I am that special and unique person that you're trying to use, God. I am, God. I am. I am. I am. I am chosen for such a time as this. It says, when you're rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. You see that? Not only are you chosen by God, but you are precious. You're his baby. You're his son. You're his daughter. There's not. It's a reason why God will go to war with the devil on your behalf. It's a reason why God will literally shut down hell and let it know like he cannot play with God's children. It's a reason why God will get off his throne and come down here and part a Red Sea and tell Moses all these things. It's a reason why God will go to war with the devil on your behalf, because you are his precious. You are his baby. He created you. He breathed his breath in your lung. You are his creation. He took his time with you. He took his time with you. See, he spoke to the world when it was bleak and void and desolate. He says, let there be light, and there was light. Let there be a division, there was a division. Let there be, but when it came to you, he breathed in you. He didn't just say, let there be men. He took his time with you. He breathed a part of him inside of your lungs, and he created you. And woman, he took his time with you. He put the man in a deep sleep and did an operation on him. So not only will you just be a woman, you will be a strong indicator of who your husband is. You are bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. I will call you woman. You are somebody's rib. Not only do you have the breath of God in you, you got your husband's rib inside of you, beating. Every time you breathe in and out, you're breathing a rib cage for protection in your lungs. God took his time with you. God took his time with you. What, baby? He took his time with you. You are special. You are more than him just speaking into your life. He's breathing with you. Every time you go in and out, breathe in and out with me for a second. Every breath is a breath that God has breathed into you. Every time that we breathe in and out, it is God breathing in and out with us. He didn't just speak a word in your life. He didn't just speak like he did to the world. He didn't just speak like he did to the cows and the ocean and all these things. He knew that you were going to be his special creation. He knew that he would love you forever. He knew this. He knew this. The very air you breathe is ordained by him. Let me keep going. Let me keep going. You are also, as living stones, being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to go offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable through Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is also contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect precious, and he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious, but to those who are disobedient, The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone and a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble being disobedient to the word to which they also were appointed. But you, let me sit here on 9. This is where God had me sit here because I'm going to read it from both. So the King James Version was the one I just jumped up and shouted in my soul with. But over here it says, but you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of the darkness into the marvelous light. Let me read the King James Version for you. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a particular people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who have called you out of dark places into the marvelous light. You are a chosen generation. They don't make them like you no more. They don't make them like you no more. You're particular. You're special. You're unique. You're exceptional. You're eccentric. You have all of these different definitions that define you. And all of it equates to you. God has chose you for this generation. You are chosen. A royal priesthood. Did you know that you're a royalty? Did you know that you had that running through your veins? If you didn't, now you know, because your father is a king. And he has many mansions. So of course you are an heir. If you are a seed of Abraham, you are indeed an heir. You might think on paper you might got $2-3 in the bank, whatever. But God is saying if you start calling those things not as though they are, you will start seeing them come into fruition. If you start speaking that you are a multi-millionaire, then you're going to start seeing it. It's going to start gravitating to you. Everything that belongs to you is going to come to you if you only believe. Keep the faith. I've lost many things in this world, but I've always kept the faith. When I didn't have what I thought I was supposed to have, but I knew it was coming, I kept the faith. When my bank account hit below negative, I knew that God was going to come in and do it because he done it before and he'll do it again. The same God is here today, tomorrow, and forevermore. I kept the faith above all else. What you can't see with your eyes, feel with your heart and your spirit. What you can't see with your eyes, see it with your heart and your spirit. Believe that you are a royal priesthood. Believe that you are a generational curse breaker. Believe that you are a generational wealth inheritance person, whatever. I can't get the words out. You understand what I'm saying. Believe that that's who you are. Keep the faith. No matter what I've lost in this world, I've always kept the faith. The same God that did it for me last time will do it again. The same God that came into the lion's den and silenced the mouths of the lions so Daniel can walk out unscathed. The same God that was in the fiery furnace with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. The same God that was in the cave with David. The same God that was out there with Elijah standing up to 450 false prophets. The same God that delivered David from Goliath. The same God. He will do it again. That same God. The one that this whole Bible is written for. The one that starts off that says in the beginning, and the one that ends off saying in Revelation, amen, because it is finished in your life. I don't know who I'm talking to, but maybe somebody just needs to hear that it is finished. That the storm is over. That everything that you've been toiling with won't be toiling with you anymore. That everything that's been going to war with you, God is saying, I've already rose up and went to war with them. God is saying, I already did it. Whatever you're thinking you're about to have to fight, God is saying it's already done. Start counting it all joy when you start facing stuff. I've been facing stuff since I crossed back over here to the United States. I'm talking about people have been writing me saying I took the money of the church and I'm doing all this stuff, making face pages and all this stuff. And I started defending myself, right? And then God says, what are you doing, Lindaria? He says, what are you doing? Aren't I the same God that took your raggedy name and turned it into a household name? So you don't think that I'm going to defend the false name that they're trying to say that you do? You don't think I'm going to come in and really do something for you? You don't think I'm going to come defend you? What are you fighting a battle for? Isn't that battle mine? Close your mouth and let me fight this battle. Close your mouth and let me fight this battle. God is saying, it is finished. It is done. I'm that same God. Stop trying to do my work and allow me to do my perfect work in you. Take your hands off the steering wheel. Take your hands off the steering wheel. Believe that God is the same God. You don't got to defend yourself. You don't got to fight. All you got to do is keep believing and keeping the faith. Keep the faith. Keep the faith. No matter what, I'm just going to keep saying it. God keep telling me to say it. To keep the faith. I know that it looks hard. I know that you're facing evictions. I know that you're facing suicide. I know that you're facing poverty and addictions and all of these things. I know that you're facing all of these insurmountable objects right now. But God is saying, I'm bigger than those. I'm bigger than those. Don't be like Doubting Thomas having to see the holes in Jesus's hands. Don't be like Peter walking on the water and all of a sudden starts looking around at his surroundings, forgetting that he was already conquering the thing that came to conquer him, that he was already doing a miracle, and begin to sink and saying, why didn't you forsake me, or whatever he said when he was drowning. And Jesus came up and immediately he got him up. Oh, ye a little faith, why did you doubt me? Don't doubt God. Don't doubt God. God isn't your problem. The devil is your problem. He's trying to make like he's so big and bad. But remember, in the Bible it says he walks around like a roaring lion. He isn't. He isn't. You got to read it. You got to read the words. You got to read into it. Because when you read it, you're like, oh, the devil walks around like a lion. Oh, the devil's a lion. No, baby. Like. There's one word that differentiates who the devil really is. Like a lion. He ain't. He ain't. He ain't never been. He ain't never been. The devil's the father of lies, the author of confusion, Beelzebub, the angel of darkness, thrown from heaven. That's who the devil is. He ain't got no kingdom. Jesus went down there to the kingdom and took back what was his. So he don't even own hell if you think about it. He don't own anything but his title. And if God wanted to, he'll take that too. He don't own anything. He's a great facade. He's a great illusionist. He loves to try to show you an image that will make you feel like you're not loved by God. Like you're not chosen. Like you're not that. But you are. You're chosen. It is written. You're chosen. It is written. You're a chosen generation. You're of royal blood. Royal priesthood. You are peculiar people. You are adopted by Christ. You have his blood that has redeemed you. All of these things are who you are. And I'm going to sign off on that note, because I'm about to go eat and enjoy the rest of my husband. Yeah, I said it. And my kids. And we're just about to have a good night. But I just want you guys to know who you are. To know. I said it. What? What, husband? Say something.
Love you too.
Listen. Don't forget who you are. I know that you're facing a lot of things. I know you're facing a lot of things. Yes, I'm going to save it and post it on YouTube and Facebook. But keep the faith no matter what. Keep the faith no matter what. And people said, I changed my name. Because on October 15, 2023, God ordained me again as Reverend by Pastor Reverend Brooke Keith. She's a pastor also. And that day she ordained me, and my last name changed because I married my husband. So my title is Reverend. My name is Lindaria Watts Mobley. And I changed it because everyday things change. You will never be the same. I didn't change it because I scammed anybody. I didn't change it because I'm trying to use anybody or confuse anybody. I changed it because on October 15th, the Lord chose me. The Lord chose me and gave me a double blessing on that day. So that's why. I love you guys. So I'm going to repost this. But if you just want to study, I'm just in Peter reading. Peter isn't even long. So if you guys want to just go with me and just start reading Peter, it will really change your life. I was on the plane reading it. I got all the way up to chapter 4. It's only 5 chapters in 1 Peter. 2 Peter is only 3 chapters. So it's really a really good read. And plus, you want to have your own relationship with God. I'm just a vessel, but you have to do the homework. So if I'm going to give you homework, it would be to read 1st and 2nd Peter. Total is 8 chapters. And you can read it all weekend. I might come in tomorrow and read a little bit more. But God did give me a special word for tomorrow or Sunday. So just tune in and I'll be back. Honeymoon is over. Your girl is back. We about to get this word on. And I thank you all for just loving me and sitting with me on this journey. Don't knock that over. On this journey.
Yes, ma'am.
And I'll be back. Love you guys. Have a great night.